whole time.
Hey there, welcome to Performers and Performing, the show where we interview anybody who considers themselves a performer about what they do. Normally, I'm here with comedians, but this week not so much, but I'm one of your many hosts, Maxwell Schultz, joined with another host this week.
Amanda Vantine.
And this week, we have two-thirds of Tiny the Bear, Anthony Sirocco, and Erica Risti.
Risti.
I'm just the worst. Risti. Erica Risti. And we're doing this from One Broadway Collaborative and also Lawrence Community Access Television. Donating to One Broadway would be very helpful, as we are a nonprofit who brings arts and community to Lawrence, Massachusetts. And you can do so at onebroadway.org. But we're joined with you guys. How are you?
Good.
Start out real light.
Yeah,
right?
I feel all right.
Fine. How are you two doing?
Yeah.
Pretty swell.
Yeah,
that's
so
good.
Good.
Yeah.
Always fun pretending we just sat down.
Yeah, right, I know.
We just sat down.
We just got here.
Right. Yeah, moments ago. Moments
ago.
Put
the mic on and took off.
Whenever it is you're listening to this, it is live. No,
we actually materialized here. So.
Yeah, it's crazy. But it's so good to be joined with you guys. You are two-thirds of my, one of my favorite like bands locally, period.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. Not to gas you guys up super a ton, but like I'm going to. But like Anthony, I met you as just Tiny the Bear before you were a trio, and I loved your music and like would request a specific song every time I'd see you. Neil Armstrong, I would request that every time I saw you, even though it was a part of every set anyways, I think. But I'd ask you to do it, and then Paul came along, who's unfortunately tied up this evening. But and I loved you guys together, and then Erica came in. I didn't know you were in the band, and then I saw you guys like a year and a half ago or something, and I was like, this is wonderful.
Thank you.
So like, you guys are just so good and so talented, and you just put out an EP with Neil Armstrong. Well, what?
We put out two singles.
Okay, yeah, I thought you were calling it an EP, I'm sorry.
It's kind of more of a double, I guess.
We're working on it.
The double album, it's very short.
Yeah.
You got to turn the record to get through half of Neil Armstrong.
A double single.
Double single.
Yeah,
yeah, it's pretty obnoxious, really. We're here to scold, but it's tremendous. I'm so happy to hear music from you guys that's recorded and not like always that I have to figure out how to get to. It's nice to have you guys quite literally on my phone in my pocket. And I've tried to make everybody I know listen to that single, so.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, like, I'm so excited, and that's part of why I like doing these and why these shows. Like, I normally book the comedians and I do those interviews, and then Aaron told me that you guys were on the 6th today, and I was like, all right, I call that one, because I've interviewed Anthony a couple times, I think. Or at least once, I don't know.
Definitely once.
And Erica's lovely, and I'd like to do this, so I'm so glad to have you guys here.
Thanks. Thank you so much, Max.
Yeah,
that was a wonderful introduction.
Thank you.
I love that.
That's why I let him do it.
Yeah.
He knows what he's
doing.
Wow. Yeah, yeah.
Make me feel special and warm inside.
Well, what else can I do?
Yeah.
If you want to show the audience what we're talking about with all this good music, you want to kick it off with a song?
Sure. Do we want to do that? Yeah.
We can.
Yeah, just pull out your phone, play the first song.
As you reel up close to the microphone. Switch up what we're doing and do... Neil instead, or?
Yeah, we can do that.
Yeah, sure, we can do that.
Yay. Give
the people what they want.
Yeah,
we'll
give the people what they want.
Give me
exactly.
What I want.
Max, give Max specifically what he wants.
Exactly. This one is called Neil Armstrong, Eat Your Heart Out. And it is on that single double, so.
Double single.
Two songs on Spotify. With a picture of a bear on it.
With
our
name,
Tiny the
Bear.
It's called Tiny the Bear, yeah. If you're listening, Lawrence.
Yeah. So weird you were both named that.
Oh, yeah. I don't know how that came to be. Oh. It's a regional thing.
Yeah.
So here we go.
¶¶
feel like you knew that right from the start. Feel you staring at me. Feel your eyes, but I don't know if you can see, so I sing. Hey! I wish I could talk to you.
I don't play music out much anymore, but whenever I do, like, I try to, and this is the part where I scold you. I say jokingly, but I usually cover, like, a local friend of mine. Like, I've covered Conor Ryan Hennessy, Jake McKelvey, Alex Sabo, and I've wanted to cover that for, but I cannot find the lyric, and I cannot memorize them, I just haven't, but I love that song.
I should put the lyrics up somewhere.
Probably.
Yeah. It's and I can such send a good them to song. You too.
Put them up on, like,
YouTube. And, like, I can send you the chords, too, for sure.
That'd be great. I love that song so much.
Okay. I have to ask where the title came from.
So I came out of thin air, honestly. Like, I just was like from the moon, I guess. But like I recently like watched somebody like sent me a link to what's that show that with like the superheroes that are like, but it's like crazy and like violent.
Oh, what
was that?
I think I know which one you're talking about, but I can't remember the title. I know it was from like the early 2000s.
It's not the boys. It's like the cartoon.
No, no, I thought we were talking about Heroes.
Yeah, but they were like, exactly. They were like Heroes, though. It's like, oh my God, I can't
not
remember.
Not drawn together, no.
No. Anyways, no, definitely not drawn together. Yeah. There's actually an episode that came out after I thought of this name, named this song, and wrote it and sang it everywhere, like years after, a couple years after, an episode called Neil Armstrong, comma, Eat Your Heart Out.
Comma's important.
So
the comma's very important.
That's so weird.
Taste the sign, synchronicities are meant to happen.
I know, but I was a little upset, because I think that somebody knew.
Somebody told somebody.
There's no way. That's such a weird coincidence.
For you.
Somebody heard something from somebody else and was like sponge brained it. We're like, Neil Armstrong, eat your heart out. That sounds like a good idea.
That's a great idea for a show. Yeah.
Good.
That's so funny and so weird. That's like when a comedian writes a joke and then like you hear a famous comedian nowhere near you and could not possibly know you tell something eerily similar.
Except
yours is exactly the same.
Exactly the same. Yeah.
Sometimes there is like joke osmosis kind of.
Yeah.
And I haven't watched the episode, but I wonder how like what it is.
It's the premise of your song too.
Oh, I didn't realize they were using your song in the middle of the
episode.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
You're owed a lot of royalties.
Right, yeah.
Once you pay attention, that's when you're owed the royalties.
Yeah, right. Once you notice. From that point on, you don't get back.
It's the meme of like the dude like beating up his like I don't know. That sounds crazy, but like never mind. But it's like it was a really popular thing for like a second there of like this like superhero like anime basically, like to some extent. Not my.
I vaguely know what you're talking about, but not well enough to tell you what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I do, and I'm sure you will prove me right soon, Erica, but I have a question for you, or a statement for you. But like, one of the first time, maybe the first time I saw you with the band, somebody said that they loved Erica joining the band because having the sax be like the bass of the band is great. And it is, but I don't feel that that's fair to you. Because you do so much more than that.
I do.
Like, you play the accordion, and you do that, and you sing back up sometimes, and like, the sax isn't always just the bass. Like, you're, I agree that it adds so much to Tiny the Bear. But, like, do you feel, like, has anybody said that to you? That, like, they love that you're, like, the bass player, essentially?
Yeah, I get that a lot, actually.
Yeah.
People really like the Barry sax, I've noticed. Oh, everywhere I take it, because I use it for other things as well, for other gigs. And just, there's kind of an alien factor to it, because it looks and sounds like something straight out of a Dr. Seuss book.
It does.
And most people don't really see one out in the wild, or really hear one for that matter, and most people also don't really see a woman playing one, too.
Fair. Not fair, but like understandable. But
yeah, no, people have said, like, oh, the Barry sax is so cool, the Barry sax. So I completely understand that people are like, oh, my God, the Barry, because it's the main thing that I do for Tiny the Bear.
Well, I think that's what sets you guys apart, too, because you have a cool mix of instruments that you don't see very often. You obviously can play multiple instruments.
Yes.
Your guitar is fantastic. Your voice is fantastic. And then Paul on violin, nobody's expecting that. You guys walk out and the music you write is so well written for what you play and it melds together so well and you guys clearly have like good musical communication. It just makes it like a kind of a one-of-a-kind experience.
Yeah, it does.
So it's definitely, I feel like a lot of people know you guys because they're like, oh, is that the guy with the violin? And we're like, yeah!
Yes.
It's very clear versus like, you know, even acoustic guitars, not that they're not good or anything, but just like having just a couple people on acoustics or even just a three-piece band with drums and bass, it's just different.
Yeah.
So it's kind of, it elevates the sound in a way that you wouldn't expect, but it makes perfect sense when you hear it. So
yeah. It does. And like I've never been to a show of yours or taken anybody to a show of yours where anybody was like disappointed or like, oh, that's not what I wanted to see. Like I won't say who it is because I know they'd be upset, but like I took somebody to one of your shows about a year ago who like goes to a lot of shows with me and is never impressed by anybody and still talks about it. Like how good you guys were.
Oh, wow.
You guys have broken through.
Yeah.
Clearly so. Like, wait, which show was this?
The one you did at the old one Broadway. When I met you. actually, the Erica.
Yes, okay. Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, if you know who I'm talking about, just don't say who it is, but like...
I don't think I do know who
it is. Okay, I'll tell you guys after the show, but there's somebody I brought to that show who, like... When I, like, I even told them today that I was interviewing you guys, and he was like, oh, that's... They're really good.
Oh, that's so sweet.
They really like
I would like
us.
To see
yeah,
them again. Like, like, you should just come with me next time I see them. Yeah. It's not that hard to see Tiny the Bear, I feel like. But, yeah, no, you guys have always, always wowed me. Like, any variation of it that you've done, the three of you, with you guys are always fantastic.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, how did the band get together? Can we hear the entire story?
The origin story of
Tiny
the Bear.
Let's hear it.
I don't know the whole thing, but I love a certain part of it.
Just start from your birth and we'll work up to.
Yeah, so Anthony was born.
Yeah, so I was born.
And then a bunch of years later.
Yeah, a lot of mental illness. But, I met Paul at a, starts with me, right?
Right.
Yes. I was the one who like started writing the songs, and I guess I don't know, I was writing music in my at my parents' house back in Everett, and I had like so many different names. Like,
really?
I went by Fogsy the Bear at one point. I was like just Tiny for a second there, and then I mixed the names together.
Yeah.
I forget what other names. I 2-Bit Tony.
I have heard other people that you've like. I've been to a show where you know people that you know for a long time call you that, and I didn't understand why.
That was the first one.
That's funny.
2-Bit Tony.
This is the first time hearing
that. That's funny.
Like I think I've heard your brother call you that. Or something.
Well, yeah, just Tony. Yeah.
Exactly. No, 2-Bit Tony. I've heard somebody say that, and I remember like turning my head like.
Yeah, okay. Right. Who? Yeah. Who-Bit Tony?
But to be fair, the first time I heard you called Tony, I was like, who?
Yeah, right, exactly. And I guess kept writing music to, I don't know, I was just like a teenager, like 18, yeah. I got my first guitar, and then I,
So you didn't start playing till you were 18?
No.
Wow.
I was 18, got it for Christmas.
And you're 19 now, so.
Yeah, exactly, right? 10 years
Rod
later.
Progress.
But then I remember I broke all the strings. I had like 3 strings left, and then I took it to this dude that I knew. I'm not gonna say his name. His name was Ridiculous.
so you took it to Ridiculous.
I took it to Ridiculous, and we went to Guitar Center, and he put all the strings back on, and then it was just like kind of history from there. All
right.
But I met up with Paul, and I think I played that show, Let's Get Weird.
Yeah.
And Paul saw me there.
Oh, at the okay.
Either the second one, I think it was, might have been.
Oh, well.
But he saw me there at, like, we had seen each other before that, but he saw me, and we kind of, like, were like, I think he was like, we should play music together.
Yeah.
And so it just kind of expanded from there. And then we went to play, like, an open mic at Gulu one night.
Okay.
And then Erica was in the crowd, and she had a saxophone, and had you played before that night, actually?
So that would be summer 2021.
Okay.
Roughly around the time I had just gotten a Barry sax.
Oh, wow.
So the Barry sax was one of my quarantine impulse purchases.
Okay.
And you started playing it in quarantine?
Oh, no. I've been playing saxophone since I was 10.
I'm like, y'all better
No. I've been playing saxophone since I was 10. I started, 9 or 10. I started when I was in the 5th grade.
Okay.
I was the only girl who played saxophone in my class.
Oh, wow.
Literally Lisa Simpson.
Yeah, yeah.
I started on alto saxophone, and then in my sophomore year of high school, I started playing tenor saxophone.
Oh.
I continued with that, and I did play Barry sax for my high school's pep band. I went to Peabody High School. So I played Barry occasionally for the pep band. Then when I went to college, I continued on tenor sax in my college's marching band. I went to UMass, go Minutemen. I marched tenor for the marching band all 4 years, and I think spring of my freshman year and spring of my senior year, I played Barry sax. So I like played Barry intermittently, but it wasn't until the quarantine when I had said, you know, we're getting all this extra money from Massachusetts. I'm never going to have this much money again. I looked at my bank account and I said, I'm not going to have this much money again. So I impulse bought a Barry sax. I had a couple of college friends of mine who worked at David French Music in Westboro. They hooked me up with a used student model tenor, Barry Sachs. And I said, I know I'm not using this now because no one's performing, but you know, once people start playing again, this will be useful.
You'll be on the hunt, and then you'll find the prey.
Yeah, yeah. Several. I ended up joining several other bands because of it. One of them being Tiny the Bear.
Yeah.
Lovely.
So this was around July 2021. I was at the Gula Gula Cafe in Salem with one of my best friends, Dana Sheridan, because she and I also play music together. She's actually got an album coming out soon. And I had my Barry with me in case anyone wanted a Barry Sachs on their set for whatever reason. So Tony and Paul were on the stage, and then Paul went, "Hey, Erica." And I said, "You want me to come up?" He said, "Yeah." So to backtrack a little bit, I met Paul by playing in a different band. I knew Paul before this, but this is when I met Tony. Mm-hmm. So I start improvising a bass line. Well, no, I think the first song we did was What You Make of It, and I started with sort of a melodic line, like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and then started improvising a bass line under what they were playing, and people seemed to like it. So we got off the stage, Paul was like, "What was that?" And my friend Dana was like, "That was magic. That was what that was. You should take this on the road. Like, you should keep doing this." And I'm like, "That would be kind of awesome." So I talked to Tony and Paul after that and saying, like, "Hey, if you want to do this, like, for real, if you want me to keep playing with you, I'm available." And Tony said, "Actually, yeah, we have a gig coming up August, if you want to hop on that." So I did. And that was like a full, I think, like 2-hour set that night. Like, we were the featured performer that night. So we got off the stage. I was packing my stuff up, and someone came up to me and said, "Oh my God, you guys are so good. Are you on any streaming services or anything, on Spotify, Bandcamp?" And I said, "I don't know. Let me ask Tony." So I shouted to Tony, and I go, "Tony, are we on Spotify or Bandcamp or anything?" And then Tony said, "You said we."
And a single tear fell out of his left eye.
Yes.
That's the part of the story I love. I'm waiting for you to say.
You said me. And then they added me to the Facebook group chat, and that's when it became official. In fact, it popped up on my Facebook memories a couple days ago. August 30th was our first photo as a trio.
Woo! Oh, wow.
It was in Paul's basement. We were just going over some stuff, some music. Because we were playing a show at Paul's Place a few days after that, and early, I want to say it was a year ago either today or a year ago a couple days ago. No, 2 years ago. Two years ago a couple days ago. It was in early September. I still think about that show very often. It was really probably one of our best performances, I got to say, as a trio. And then we just kept playing.
Yeah.
The rest is history.
Yeah.
Was that Heckfest?
No, that was not. No, it was, I think it was just a punk show at Paul's Place.
Okay.
No.
Because you're a very punk band.
Yeah.
I forget the other bands there. I want to say it was Dad Doxer, Onthay.
Okay. Yeah, I remember that.
I can't remember the exact lineup.
Yeah, but I do remember that now.
That's so cool, though.
I've been playing for them with 2 years now.
Yeah, that's awesome. And that's what happens when you put yourself out there, too. Like, if you're going out to open mics and then people are like, "Hey, you're good. You want to jam?" And then you're like, "Okay." That's and then there are more people who are like, "Can I, like, play with you guys?" You're like, "Hell yeah."
Yeah. It's honestly great networking. Like, so I've met some really great musicians through open mics.
Absolutely.
And jams and such.
Yeah.
That was the first time I saw you was at Fodies. Solo
okay,
with
Fodies,
I
had said Riverwalk, but yes, Fodies.
Yeah,
yes,
well, Riverwalk, and then we'd go
right,
Fodies,
right, exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Right next door.
I remember seeing you and being like, "That guy has talent. That is good." And then now seeing the full band, it's like, "Well, aren't you just piling it on there?" That is awesome.
Yeah, you guys are so good.
So, are you the main songwriter? How do you guys approach songwriting as a group, as an individual, where you bring songs to each other? How does that work? I love to pick artists' brains about that.
So, usually, I write the songs acoustic guitar, singing, and then I bring it to these guys, and they just
go hard. Oh, it's like handing them a blank canvas,
it's
and they're
so
like,
beautiful. Yeah, Laura, every time.
Laura loves, like Paul and I will just kind of like noodle along to whatever Tony's playing. Yep. Or Tony will send like a recording of what he has through our Facebook group chat.
Yep.
And we kind of like will individually just like noodle and in my case, I figure out what instrument I want to use.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's really just Tony's the main songwriter. He writes really good songs. and Paul and I just kind of play around with them and see what we can add.
Yeah. It feels very organic. Because you like something that you hear that you do, you keep it, and then if you want to revise it, you can, but it seems like you're pretty open-minded, so you're like, here, do what thou will.
Pretty much, yeah,
you
exactly.
You know your instrument,
and then,
you know?
And then if, like, you know, I'll hear something that's, like, kind of cool or whatever that I think sounds good, I'll just be like, hey, do that again, you know? Like,
yeah. Keep that. Well, like, yeah. Do this instead. Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly. Put that at this part. Yeah, exactly.
That's very cool. Awesome. So there's still like a teamwork aspect to it, especially with you guys playing completely different instruments. Everyone's bringing something totally different to the table.
Oh, absolutely.
How do you decide what instrument you're going to play? Is it just based on the song, kind of how it makes you feel?
More or less, yeah. Like for Wouldn't Have It Any Other Way, one of our newer tunes, it's a very quiet, contemplative. I don't know if contemplative is the right word. It's a very like delicate song. Yeah. It's very pretty. So I use a kalimba, a thumb piano for that. Or for like fun, goofy songs like like Neil Armstrong, Eat Your Heart Out, Couch Cushion Eject Button. That's a Barry Sachs tune. One that can like, and I can totally see like a boom, ba boom, 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 like bass line to it. But for kind of some of the more poignant songs that we have, like Good Enough and Bye Bye My Love, it's very much accordion tunes because accordions kind of can express this sort of haunting sound.
Absolutely.
That really lends itself to the kind of song.
Yeah.
It allows you to do a little bit more because it's basically like a portable organ.
Yeah. It's like a toolkit that you have that you can kind of just add to the song whatever is begging to be added. They're so drastically different as instruments.
Oh, yeah.
That's probably what helps shape the sound so much. Violin is always haunting to me. It's one of my favorite instruments. I just think it's absolutely gorgeous.
And Paul does it so well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. He's very talented.
He does.
So you write a great song. He's doing violin and you pick out of your toolkit, and it just, the way it comes together is so good. I love it.
Thank you. This isn't even the whole collection. There's
so what else do you play?
So the full list is
he's all like, right, here we go.
Full list. Get comfy. piano, guitar, tenor sax and barry sax, so saxophone, hand percussion, ukulele, mandolin, accordion, melodica, kalimba, penny whistle, fife, Celtic harp, and I sing.
Celtic harp? Wow. You're just going to throw that in towards the end? Are you kidding me?
So like, things like fife and Celtic harp, I'm still like kind of beginner level at, but there are things that I do know how to play.
Yeah.
I actually use a Celtic harp on my friend Dana Sheridan's, one of my friend Dana Sheridan's songs. But I would say my main instruments are saxophone and accordion.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Did you learn piano before learning accordion?
Yes, piano was my first instrument.
Was it an easy transfer? Because it looks like it, but with the other side, like how is that? I play piano and I've like always wanted to learn accordion, so I'm like, just let me pick your brain for a second.
I would say so. Yeah, definitely the right hand. Certainly the right hand, but the left hand kind of took some figuring out. But when you're a 14-year-old kid with, you know, ADHD that doesn't get diagnosed for another 12 years, and you can really hyper-focus.
You got the
hyper-focus. Like, yeah, it's. I'm really not a good person to ask. Was the learning the accordion easy for you? Like, yes, because I was gifted. Now I'm a burnt-out adult. His brain doesn't work good.
ADHD works out in some people's favor. You're like, I could play the fife, the harp.
It really does. It has served me well in that regard. Not so much in other respects, but it is. I'm really like. I'm kind of glad that I had that hunger for learning more, like more
yeah.
instruments.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because it's really, really quite useful.
Oh, totally.
And I'm
absolutely.
Very grateful for my family for being supportive of that.
yeah,
absolutely.
And like shrugging, like when your kid tells you, "I want to learn the accordion," they're like,
"That sounds
all right." yeah. Gotta get you a monkey now too.
Yeah,
I guess.
yeah. That cool hat.
Yeah, matching hats.
Yeah. Do you guys want to play another song?
Sure.
Yeah. For sure. Yep. Absolutely.
All right.
Yeah,
choose
since
your
we've been
instrument.
Talking
after.
About it.
Yeah.
Good time.
This one's called "Feeling Things." Ugh. Dude.
Yeah.
Things just because I'm alive. I'm tired of feeling things that never feel right. Spooky spells sent from hell, just as well always me. My feelings have a pretty damn good hold on me. Everything is my fault. I'm tired of feeling things that make me feel like I feel nothing at all. Cause sometimes I feel like I haven't had a feeling since I was 17. My feelings have a pretty damn good hold on me. Feeling things. Crowd. And I'm tired of feeling things that make me feel like no one wants me around. But the people who surround me, they wanna be around me. I love them, and they love me. My feelings don't have that good a hold on me.
Accordion too, like you could picture it with two acoustic guitars, and that would be awesome. It's well written, the lyrics are great, but then you're just like, let's just swap one of those out for an accordion and see how it sounds.
And add a violin too.
And add a violin too. Yeah,
love it.
He adds a lot to it too.
Oh, I'm sad he's not here.
I know,
Paul.
Paul,
you're watching this.
Yeah.
When you are watching, in Lawrence.
Yeah, when you're in Lawrence and watching this.
Either way, I'll get this video and I'm gonna show it to him.
Yeah, you should.
Paul.
You
who
should.
What camera am I looking at?
That one.
The middle one.
That guy.
One. You should have been here. Really messed up.
Boo.
Yeah.
Hopefully he's not doing something too important.
Right. He's like, I had a wake.
Yeah.
I was going to say that he had another Tiny the Bear interview that he booked elsewhere that you guys aren't at.
Yeah, right.
He's just playing the violin lines to your song.
Yeah, everybody's just like, what's going on here?
Yeah, he's like, I swear there's normally two other people.
Yeah, how often do you guys practice? What is the, do you guys have a regimen? Is it just kind of scattered depending on your schedules or...
We're trying to get better about practicing more often. It really depends on our schedules.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you do like long distance, like where you send each other stuff and kind of like practice alone, and then when you get together at a gig, you don't really have to worry about it because you have technically practiced?
Somewhat, yeah. Like if Tony has something that he wants to show us, but we don't have practice for like a really long time, he'll send it over our Facebook group chat, and then we'll listen and say like, oh, I really like this bit. I'm thinking this song, this instrument for this song, this, that, and the other thing. But usually we'll like try to meet up one or two times before a gig.
Sure.
Just so we can figure out what we want to play, work on some newer material too.
Mm-hmm. Yay. Do you guys have new material in the works?
Oh,
we
definitely.
Yes. There is so much new material.
Yay.
There is a lot of new material.
There is a lot coming.
But a lot of people do like hearing a lot of our old favorites.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
But we are working on some fresh new tunes.
Soon they'll be their new favorites.
Yes. Yeah. New favorites.
Yes.
I wish I was better at songwriting. I wish I knew how to write good songs so I could contribute more to writing to Tiny the Bear.
You could.
I'm more of a, like, I don't really do lyrics super well. I'm more of a melodic instrumental.
Which is a huge element to the songwriting, really.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
right.
Especially in the three-piece, no drums, like all the rhythm and the melodic, you know, melodies that you guys create, you almost forget that there ever was going to be a drum. You don't need it because it's so full. The sound is so like well embodied.
Mm. Funny you should mention that. We were considering either like adding a drummer or I
learn cajon.
I actually have a cajon in my car as we speak.
How did I know?
I have a rhythm egg in my stand bag. But I was thinking like of some kind of percussion rig. Like either a foot tambourine
or a kick pedal
against a cajon.
Yep.
Yeah.
Or
a kick pedal on one foot, tambo on the other.
Yeah.
And those backwards kick pedals, so the back is a snare.
That too, yeah. Right, there's a number of ways.
And this one attached your tongue too.
Yeah. Like a strap around.
Think, think. Yeah. Every time you wink, it like does a symbol.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, let's let some attach to my eyelids.
Yeah.
It's painful. It's like Wolverine pain.
Or like ideally something that would allow me to also move around too.
Yeah.
We've been thinking about adding some kind of percussion element to it just to sort of complete that.
Yeah.
But we have a basically a whole album recorded at this point.
We're just tweaking it and putting some final touches on it before we send it off into the world.
Yeah,
that's so exciting.
same thing. We had Paul record it.
Yeah,
for us, we all just kind of recorded in Paul's house, the three of us.
That's so cool.
That is
nice
awesome.
That's so cool.
And then you know it comes out exactly how you want it to sound. Yeah, every song is exactly how you imagined it, thought it would be, envisioned it, you know, tailored it to be. So that's really cool.
I mean, that's speaking from self-experience. Like, that's why any like spoken word thing I've done, I've had the same producer, because like I trust him and know he's doing what I want to do.
Yeah,
and he's a very close friend. So
right.
But I totally get that. Like wanting that control instead of sending it somewhere and. That person sends it to another person, maybe, and like that's.
I used to record with a guy who would try to take every one of my songs and be like, "Yeah, but what if we added like some '80s wet drums?" And I'm like, "No, wet drums. Let go of the '80s drums, dude. They're not going to be in there."
He'd tailor the song and send
it back to me, and I was like. This sounds like an 80s rock song. He's like, you like it? I'm like, no. I don't want it that way if that's how I wanted it.
Right.
Yeah, so
right.
It does keep the element of control in your hands.
I haven't even attempted to like have somebody produce music for me in a long time. I haven't been in a band in forever, but spoken word-wise, it's a totally different game.
Oh, yeah.
I don't want to go back to producing or trying to have somebody produce music for me.
Yeah,
that's a headache I don't want right now. But
and if you already know how to do it well yourselves,
like right,
that's already a whole nother beast, animal, talent, whatever in and of itself. So.
Yeah, so that's awesome.
It makes a lot easier, certainly, to have Paul kind of at the helm of all our recording and audio technology too.
He clearly has like the knowledge to produce and record songs.
That is awesome.
That's awesome.
So you guys really just do it all, huh?
More or less.
Well, that's great.
I do a little less.
You're the one writing the song.
You're right.
That's a huge component.
Yeah.
It really does feel like, regardless of who's doing what, everyone's putting equal weight on the table, and what's coming together is like totally everyone's envision, you know, and it looks great, sounds great, you know.
We each bring something different to the table. Like Tony is, you know, the songwriter, and our front man, Paul, is our, Paul's our violinist and also audio technology. And yeah. also he's connected to a lot of people, a lot of booking people in the area.
Nice.
And I have instruments. I have a lot of instruments and
enthusiasm, and you show up on time.
So. Yeah, exactly, right?
Yeah, and yeah, I give me, words are hard, man.
That's okay.
Yeah,
so that's hard.
Okay. I understand that, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, no, so I'm able to pick up like little details in music just because of how my brain is.
Sure.
So I usually like go through the songs with a very, my brain is a fine tooth comb. Usually I'm picking up on my own playing because I'm my own worst critic. Oh, I'm like, my Barry's out of tune there. Oh no, I didn't like the way my thing sounded. And like Tony and Paul are like, Erica, this sounds fine. Like, no, I sound bad.
I'm also a sax player, so like I get what you're saying. Like I feel like for sax players specifically, there's that like thing of like, oh, but it's just this much out of tune.
It's that. Mm. Yeah, well, our instruments are just so notoriously out of tune.
Yeah.
It's a problem.
Is that a sax thing? I didn't know.
Yeah. It really is. Sax.
Do you tune a sax?
Oh yeah. You can tune a sax. So you tune it
by
moving the mouthpiece up and down the neck.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, you can tune a sax. It goes out of tune super easy, depending on the weather, the temperature, the cosmos aren't aligned, the stars not being in position.
You hiccuped. Yeah.
Mercury retrograde's a bad time to gig.
Yeah. Mercury's in Gatorade. Mercury's in Powerade. But. Yeah.
So speaking of gigging, how often do you guys gig? How do you like gigging? What, like, let's hear your best and your, maybe not your worst if you don't want to talk about it, but like, you know, what's your experience playing to a packed place versus like five people, or like, how do you bring the same energy? How do people respond? I just asked you like 16 questions. So you can
one word answer, one word answer.
We give the same energy to a five-person crowd as we do to like a packed bar.
Sure.
We play for the people that want to be there.
Yeah.
Right.
And I bet they come next time too, because the show's just as good as if there had been 35 people there. You know.
Yeah. Sometimes. But yeah, it's really just we show up, we do the gig to the best of our ability, and we play for the people who we know want to be there.
Yeah.
And you know, if no one's really digging our vibe, then we're just sort of, we're playing for ourselves, and we're having a good time doing what we do.
Yeah, loving what we're doing, exactly.
Yeah. And I mean, you guys should.
It's, we very much do.
Yeah.
It's
clear, too, because, like, I mean, anybody watching this has seen it twice today, at least, because I've noticed it twice. But Anthony does this thing where, like, when Erica, you or Paul are playing, and you do something, like, cool, you have this, like, giant grin of like, that's in the song now.
Yeah.
Yeah, awesome. Exactly, yes.
It's awesome.
It.
Yeah.
No,
I always notice those things.
The energy between us three it's very much there. It's very there. It's very palpable. And we just try to kind of spread that energy to whatever, wherever we're playing.
Right.
Yeah, you can clearly tell you guys are like actually good friends as well.
Yeah.
So there's a friendship bond, there's a musical bond.
Yeah.
So that's really cool.
We're not
to
just
have.
Coworkers.
Right.
Yeah,
exactly.
Right.
Yep, 9 to 5.
You don't want
it
to feel like a job outside of your whatever your work is, you know. If you're finding enjoyment from it, it's gonna feel like so much more fluid and easy to be able to make music together, perform together, all that. So that's really cool.
That is really
How often do you guys perform? Or does it depend?
It does depend.
It really depends, sometimes there's like a gig drought. Sometimes
that's true.
We get there were a couple times where we had, you know, a weekend of Tiny the Bear gigs.
That's cool.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean recently we've had a pretty good chunk actually.
Yeah, we just played Bit Bar in Salem for the Hope Fest pre-show. Where did we go before that?
I can't really
remember.
It might
have been either a you and Paul show.
I mean, I know that I played here just recently.
You did?
So
that's true.
I'm going to be playing here on Saturday. So.
Oh, nice.
It's coming Saturday?
Yeah.
That's another thing about Tiny the Bear is that it's very, we can be travel sized. Like sometimes Tiny the Bear is just Tony, or sometimes Tiny the Bear is Tony and Paul, or Tony and me.
Yep.
But yeah, no, Saturday I'm playing at a wedding.
Yep.
but it's, it, it, I feel like we don't gig often enough. I want to gig more with Tiny the Bear because I love playing with this band so much. I'm a full-time musician and I'm a side woman for all these other bands who whatever band needs a horn player, multi-instrumentalist. But I would say like Tiny the Bear is like my home bass band it's one of the few bands that I'm in, I guess, that I'm like a core member of.
Yeah. Okay.
But yeah, I can't think of when like our next gig as a trio is. I don't know. Book us, please.
Know. Yeah, right. Give us a call,
here.
Dude. Yeah,
get
right.
us gigs.
Not only do we like guess, you to maybe. Donate to One Broadway Collaborative, please book Tiny the Bear.
Yeah.
All good things.
Yes.
I was just trying to think of like a really awful experience, but like gigging, just because you said like what are some of the best and what are some of the worst.
If you don't have one, that's good.
But I feel, okay, but...
I have one that comes very fresh to mind.
There was the time that you and Paul were in that place in Lowell, and there was, like, audio problems or...
In Lowell.
It's like a bank vault or something.
Oh, but that was fun, though.
I can't think of, like a really profoundly gig experience.
There was one time I went to the Stu who lived in New Hampshire. That you probably know, actually.
Probably.
But he like did like house shows.
I know exactly who it is.
And, and like it was actually a splendid night.
Wait,
you were there, weren't you, that night?
Was it like a New Year's thing or something?
I forget what it was.
It was a holiday vaguely around
maybe Halloween.
Could have been Halloween.
I remember that night was so much fun, but. Very interesting house to go into.
Yeah,
like
okay.
There was like basically like a cardboard moat that went into the and like you walked over this like cardboard moat, and then there was while we were like sitting in there because it was just like the doors were like wide open. We were like getting like bit by like mosquitoes.
Yep.
It was like insane.
I have not thought about that night in a long time.
But that was such a good night too. On top of it,
I don't care.
I'll take all the mosquito bites.
Yeah, that was great.
I was gonna say my mind immediately goes to like I had a gig one time where we had just got new gear and we had set it up at home and it sounded so good and we got to the gig, doesn't work. We got a preamp that was used and it was faulty, and so it would work sometimes and it would work. And so we ended up using like a mic and two tiny little QSEs that they use for bingo night. Mm. And a guy that doesn't even work there but is a frequent at the bar was like, oh, I'll go get it from the closet. And like a patron went and got it and set it up for us mid-set. And they still paid us the full amount of money.
Yeah.
And we played for like maybe 45 minutes out of 2 hours.
Whoa.
And it was so terrible and so embarrassing. Mm. And then they invited us back. We played there like 5 more times. It's fine, I guess. It was like, you probably have played there, Merrimack Ales in Lowell. It's an ale house or like a brewery, so it's like huge, amazing acoustics on the inside because it's just like high vaulted ceilings and big vats of beer. But they have like a dock bay that is kind of like a stage, and then they put like seating down below. And so we're just standing up in the opening like, ha ha, give it a minute, we'll get there.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what the fuck going on?
Should have had me open.
Yeah. We got a bunch of jokes about it.
Yeah.
We would have just glided in 45 minutes left to go and saved the day.
I can do an hour 15.
I would say probably the worst gigs we get are probably just like the dingy dive bars. You know, like sometimes those can just be weird. And
I think no matter what you're
very
performing,
hit or miss.
Yeah,
like
right.
Sometimes
exactly.
they listen, sometimes they don't, and it's also like a dingy dive bar.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Creepy dudes. Yeah.
A bunch of drunk people are like trying to rage, and you're playing beautiful music, and they're probably like, "Yeah, slam the accordion!" And you're like, "This isn't the vibe."
We did have people start a mosh pit to one of our songs.
Okay, that is like a bucket list material.
It was. I said it at the show. I was like, "That was a mosh pit." And we just
that was
started
the first
a pit.
Mosh pit to our song. Yeah, it was at
what song was it?
I think it was What You Make of It.
Oh, okay.
Cool. Folk Fest 2022. Yeah.
Lovely. Mm-hmm.
And then there was, we get asked to play Hugh O'Neill's in Malden pretty often. And I think the first time we were there, there was this hockey tournament, I guess, that had just got out. So a bunch of hockey dudes pile into Hugh O'Neill. And we were playing Neil Armstrong, Eat Your Heart Out. And this one of the hockey bros was so moved by that song, he requested that we play it again. So we played it again just for him, and he brought out this trophy that I guess they won from the tournament and laid it at our feet.
Oh, wow.
Like it was a shrine.
It was so cool.
Okay, that's actually
that is
epic.
Really
cool. Yeah, it was really epic, and I hope that, man, I hope they're all living their best lives. I hope
they probably already heard your new double singles. He has heard them. He knows you. He's watching.
Hopefully.
Yeah, probably.
Hockey bros, wherever you are. I hope you're living your best life.
Yes.
Oh, that's epic.
I think the trophy was like broken at the time too.
Yeah,
they didn't have it for very long before they broke. Well, they're hockey guys.
That sounds right. Yeah, that sounds correct.
It was like broken and like the
like
guy was
to the
like
side. It was very charming.
It was nice. It was awesome. We got a picture of it on Instagram.
Right on. And you never know, like if you're in a bar and like a group of people walk in, especially like a bunch of sports people all rowdy from a game, you're like, this could go one of two ways.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I was thinking it.
And they're like crying at the foot of the stage and like, more. Here's a trophy. That's epic.
That's what you'd want, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Nice, yeah. That's the best.
Cool hockey dudes. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, they were cool. We lucked out. They were really cool hockey dudes.
Yeah.
Well, I feel like with talent like you guys have, you can't really have a bad gig, like unless there was some sort of like technical difficulty and no one could hear you, but
or unless there's like really awful, deplorable people there.
Which
just
does
like
happen.
Yeah. That happens every now and then.
People who will like harass. Nobody's come up to us and like heckled us or harassed us or anything.
That's a good point, actually. Yeah,
but then again,
good.
Do you really want to mess with someone who's really tall, someone who plays instruments half her size, and Paul?
Down and knock him over. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Exactly.
You want to play another song?
Yes.
I'm
going to
transition out of what Erica just said, but I wish I did.
Let's do it.
We do.
We got one more.
Yeah.
Yay, we get to hear
you. To more or less round us out.
This is the this is the one with the kalimba.
Yeah. Hooray.
Called Wouldn't Have It Any Other Way. Give us a moment. It's okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
This is a song I wrote for the people that I love. You know who you are. It's unfortunate that I couldn't fit all of your names in it. So just know that when I sing it, thinking about you, and I wanna say I wouldn't have it any other way. Song only has four chords to speak of at best, and a catchy chorus at the end of every verse, I guess. But I wrote it this way for a reason, and the reason to remind me every day wouldn't have it any other way. I know life can get hard and bitter sometimes. Then again, other times it's much easier to bite. And plus the times and situations and priceless conversations always make everything okay. So I wouldn't have it any other way. is a song I wrote for the people that I love. You know who you are.
If I was in a mood and I heard that, I would bawl my eyes out.
Thank you.
If I was in a mood, I'd be like, oh, this was devastatingly
that's so
beautiful.
Good. Yeah, that's such a good closer, too.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you for doing that song.
Thank you for being here. Us.
Like,
yeah,
that was
totally.
Just
totally.
So cool.
Thanks for having us. Yeah, you guys are great.
Thank you. You were great. I mean,
you're awesome. Yeah.
Wonderful host.
We're good. We're good.
You're fine. You'll do.
I'm fine.
You're good.
With a couple minutes left, we have these little like token things in the middle of the table. It's usually up here when there's one person guests. And I give them when
I'm
on.
I didn't see these until.
Right. Yeah. This is what I brought today. Okay. This is what I brought. His head's kind of melted.
Well,
we don't have enough time for the whole spiel, but ultimately, I get these guys the question: what is like your favorite childhood McDonald's toy? Or like this one's Burger King, so whatever.
Did they have Beyblades at some point?
Probably.
I believe they did.
I think that was it. I think once I got I got a Beyblade as a kid. I was happy.
Yeah.
I was like, I got a Beyblade.
What more could I want?
Yeah, it was a good day.
Right, today was a good day.
I would say, I don't know, probably it had to have been one of like the, I think they had these like plushies on a keychain.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Disney characters.
Yep.
I want to say it was one of those, either that or it was one of the, they had these like little collective statuettes. I remember getting one of Flick from A Bug's Life.
Yeah, that's like a deep memory, but yes.
Yeah, those for McDonald's. So I was kind of partial to Burger King. But I think of McDonald's toys is probably one of the like the plushy soft keychains.
Hey, thanks. Cool. I picked these two because I want to see you look like this.
I'm going to try.
I like, you don't need the cane, I guess. It's I think broken, but he does, the whole thing this thing does is this, there's a switch in the back.
That's amazing.
Switch in the back.
I don't know, Burger King, but, and then Erica, I got you this shark driving a shark looking car.
Oh, yes.
There it is. Because I feel like since you joined the band, things are fast.
Yeah. And it's a good
so if you want, you can take these with you when you leave.
Oh my goodness,
so
thank
sweet.
You.
I have
that's
way
such a
too many
to
of them to begin
it's
with.
It's not a broken trophy, but we try.
Yeah, yeah. Well, again,
I'm going to go as that guy.
The man's head is kind of melted. I don't know what would have happened, but I bought these at Savers. So.
Just a tad too close to a candle.
Yeah, probably. That's what it kind of looked like. I thought it was Silly Putty at first, and then I realized it was head.
That's fine.
That's all right.
It's probably a little more mischievous than that, but
well,
you know, it's like,
probably.
But I have no idea what either of these are from. But before we get out of here, is there anything you guys want to plug? Any
socials,
album dropping? Yes.
Where are you playing?
Yeah, so I'd say we're Tiny the Bear. We're on Instagram. You can follow us on Instagram. You can follow us on Facebook. We are on Spotify, Apple Music now. So if you type in Tiny the Bear, you can find us there. We're on a bunch of different other platforms, musical platforms as well. We're on YouTube, TikTok. I can't remember them all. They're from, you know, DistroKid puts out a lot of things. But mainly, you know, Apple Music, Spotify. We got a couple old songs on Bandcamp. I have to update those, but we'll have a couple on Bandcamp soon, too. Those
cool.
For sure.
Any upcoming gigs?
Besides the solo gig that Tony has here, I don't know.
Okay. Yeah.
Stay tuned. Follow our socials.
Yeah. We'll let you know.
Yeah.
Yay.
Yeah.
So Saturday at, I think, 8, Aaron, I believe? Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll be playing at one Broadway Collaborative, which you should donate money to.
Yes.
Yeah.
Bring it a full circle.
Right. And now we just play this on a loop, and it's just an infinite track. But thank you guys so much for being here. Really appreciate you both.
So much fun.
Yes.
You guys are so
absolutely.
Talented.
This has been Performers on Performing. I'm Max Schultz.
Amanda Vantine.
And Tiny the Bear.